it during the speaker session. During the session, one or more poll questions will be posted and all the participants are requested to attend the poll question. I request the participants who has logged in through mobiles to accept all the pop-ups notifications related to Zoom to answer the poll question. After the end of speaker's lecture, participants will be given chance to ask their questions to speaker by raising their hand. Each questioner will get chance on first come, first serve basis. Speaker will answer the questioner offline in case of out of time that is mentioned. At the end of each session, all participants are requested to fill the feedback form. The link will be posted in the chat box present here. And note, link will not be posted in WhatsApp groups. Poll question answering and feedback for every session is must to get e-certificate. At the end of this 1 week program, all participants will receive the e-certificate through email. Today's session will start in few minutes. Thank you.
Hello. Hello, Principal sir. Good morning, participants. I now hand over the session to my friends A. Kapil Kumar and A. Shravanti to take forward. Over to you, Kapil sir.
Good morning to all the participants. I, A. Kapil Kumar, on behalf of our organizing team, feels it's my pleasure to invite today's speaker, Dr. J. Praveen Garu, Principal of GRIIT. Dr. Praveen J. has done his PhD from Usmania University in Power Electronics, Hyderabad. He is registered as PhD guide at Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, JNTUH. He has published 20 Scopus CSI papers. He has international certification on high impact teaching skills by Dale Carnegie and Associate INC, Trainers USA, Mission 10X, Wipro Technology. He is certified as a LabVIEW Associate Developer from NIUSA. He received 100 lakhs DST FIST project, which is ongoing. He has also received Young Scientist Award from Department of Science and Technology with 29 lakhs grant, 30 lakhs USAID consultancy project on energy system professional training. He received Best Teacher Award and Best Project Award from Indian Society for Technical Education, ISTE. He is senior member of IEEE FIE. He has many international certifications from edX, Udemy, and Coursera. Today, we request him to share his knowledge on innovative teaching methods. Sir, now we request you to take the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Kapil sir. Thank you, Sanya madam.
Thank you, sir.
So, are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
kindly stop annotations and then proceed, sir.
Again, yeah, I had to do that.
Yes, sir. Every moment you share the screen, you got to do that. Help.
So already I think it is stopped only.
Okay, sir. Disable participants annotation. If that is ticked.
Already it is disabled.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good morning to one and all. I think now we have 188 participants. Generally, how many are there, madam?
400. We are touching 400.
Okay, okay. So they will be slowly joining.
We started a bit like a 5 minutes early, sir, today.
But what is time now?
10:30. It's now 10:28.
Okay, then we will wait for 2 minutes.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So good morning to one and all. So today I would like to discuss innovative teaching methods for engineering education. So most of we are now have a challenge in front of us to teach online actually. So as now we are in this pandemic corona break, so we require to take online classes, and we should have quality content, and we should have that ability to make online course like Coursera or Udemy or Swayam, sitting at home or maybe coming to college. So this is a totally a new paradigm shift actually. So that we need to upgrade ourselves to this new online technology, online tools. So I would like to share my views with respect to this innovative teaching methods for engineering education. So basically, as we are talking with respect to engineering education, so we need to be in line with the NBA graduate, because online teaching is there for school children as well as for non-technical students also. But now this online teaching is with respect to engineering students. So we should also see that what type of things we need to consider. So if you see NBA graduate, so first one is mathematical knowledge actually. So we need to inculcate. So whenever we design course, whenever we are taking classes, so we need to keep in the mind that we need to inculcate this mathematical knowledge in them actually. So we should try to focus more on mathematical knowledge. So wherever the mathematical complex things are coming, so try to elaborate this mathematical concept, ask them, give them some assignments, and see that they will harness their mind on this mathematics. So that is very important, because in future they need to solve very complex problems actually. Then problem analysis. So we need to see that when we are taking classes, either online or offline, we need to focus more on this problem analysis. So we need to take students through this problem analysis, and it is like the more you teach, the less student is going to learn. So what we have to do is we should give more focus to student learning. So what we should do is we should teach less and see that student participate actively in the classes in problem analysis. So break them in teams, give them some activity in class, and see that we should harness their mind in problem analysis. Then design development of solution. So all this engineering education is with respect to solving solution. So you see, if you take average placement across India, it is about say 35 to 40%. But we are happy that at our college, at GRIT, we have 70% placements. But if you see overall, some rural colleges, they may not have placements. And some colleges, they have meager placements. So, and some top colleges, they have good placements. But on average, engineering graduates, let us say they have 40% placement across the India. So if you can make them to design and development of solution, because industries have lot of problems. Why they are operating those industries? To solve the social problems. So if you can prepare students to solve the problems, so then only we can make them employable. Then conduct investigation of complex problems. So the social problems, the industry problems, the problem in industry is complex in nature. So future problems are not very simple. Now let us say this corona, this is a problem. And if you see in news, if you see, so people are using drone, people are using artificial intelligence, people are using 3D printing, you name additive manufacturing, you name any technology. So people are using those technologies, see that how this pandemic can be controlled or how this corona can be controlled. So they have developed apps, so lot of things are going on. So every problem requires investigation of complex problems. So we should make our students to analyze these complex problems and create solution for that. Then modern tool usage. So there are so many tools. You can say MATLAB is there. There are maybe PSpice is there, or you have Python is there, or so many softwares are there. R programming is there. So some are paid, some are free. So maybe students immediately they cannot pay, or they may not have access in colleges, the paid software. So they can access Python is there, R is there. There are many softwares. They can access from home at free of cost. But what students will do generally, they spend a lot of time on chatting. They spend a lot of time on reading news, maybe in Twitter or other things. But slowly we have to motivate them to use this modern tools and see that they will be able to use these new tools. Engineers and society. So we should also think about engineers and society. So if you make a very good product, but let us say it is hazardous, so then we have a lot of difficulties when it goes to the society. For example, you develop a cell phone, and let us say it is blasting when you are charging. So who is going to use that cell phone? So one small error can damage the company, and the company itself can collapse. So unless we teach our students that the engineering, finally it should be applicable to society. Then individual and teamwork. So this is very important point. So generally Indians are very good at individual work. But when it comes to teamwork, they have a lot of challenges, a lot of problems, because people are coming from various backgrounds. So various communities, various social backgrounds, regional backgrounds. So many things are there. So you see in America now what is happening. So a lot of problems are there. So why? So because lack of teamwork. So people to understand how to work in teamwork. So it is challenging, but we should inculcate. So how to start? So initially we should work in teams. So teachers, department, if you see in your college, so whether the departments can work in team, it is hardly, I can't say that people can work. So let us say if you can make civil engineering and EC, let us say civil engineering want to use some IoT application. So whether EC department will help them. So that is a challenging task. So whether ECHOD spares their faculty to help civil department and vice versa. So generally people don't like to work in teams. So that if we try to inculcate in us, then finally we can teach student also. So we need to improve upon this teamwork. Then communication. Communication is very important. So communication is three types. So one is listening skill, then writing skills, then oral communication skills. So even whenever we want to even write a paper, write a project book, make a project proposal, whatever you want, this communication skill is very important. So as a senior teacher, we should have this skill, then we should guide our young faculty members as well as students also to improve their communication skills. Then coming to environment and sustainability. So if you see now whatever we are consuming, so we require maybe 4 to 5 earth to either produce or consume the wastage what we are producing. Let us say we produce a lot of plastic, we throw them that plastic goes in oceans, and a lot of ocean marine life is getting disturbed with respect to this wastages, whatever we are producing. So we are not able to treat this wastage properly. So with respect to that, so a lot of challenges are coming. So we are spoiling the marine life. You see jungles, Australia, you have seen what happened. So it caught a fire. So when the fire is when we are urbanizing, so we are cutting trees, and the temperature is rising, and whenever some small fire is happening in the forest, so entire forest, and you see lot of wildlife has gone in Australia. It is also happening in America. In India also, recently I've seen. So people are not really animal friendly actually. So they are trying to kill animals, and they are not treating animals properly. So if we are not thinking about environment and sustain, what we will give to our children? When finally, let us say, our children and their children, nothing will be there. Except this corona, or except this heat wave, except this damage ozone layer, ultraviolet radiation, no pure water. So a lot of challenges are there. So everybody should think about the environment and ethics. Ethics is very important. So ethics is like students are over. So they try to cheat in examination. In project work, when they are writing, they try to copy. When they are publishing papers, they'll try to lift data from somewhere else. So if we don't have ethics, then the credibility will be less actually. So one has to inculcate. Unless we practice ethics, we cannot really teach our younger generation, faculty members, as well as students with respect to ethics. So ethics and values are very important. So that we need to slowly inculcate among students and faculty members. So another word for ethics is culture also. So we should create a good ambience, good culture. Then project management and finance. So generally engineers, they are good at engineering, mathematical skills. When come to finance, project management and finance, they will be weak. So we need to think how we can develop. So, and lifelong learning. So now you see, now also we are learning. So today, maybe last week also, I'm continuously learning. I participate in many courses. I learn through Coursera, edX, Udemy, whatever. So always I try to learn and see that I should be having updated knowledge. So this lifelong learn, this is very important. If you see, for example, the Redmi phone, every 3 months, 4 months, he is able to release a new phone. In this pandemic also, now I think in 1 or 2 days, he is releasing one more phone. You see, he is able to capture the market, technology. So how people are working, just understand. So there should be a lot of planning is required. Then only they can release such products in the market. So if you compare India, you see what happened to Nokia, and similarly, whether how good we are at cell phone manufacturing or 3D printing or automation with respect to China and USA. So there is a lot of things required to be learned actually. So that is why, so whatever we learn in our colleges and whatever things are there right now, so a lot of gap is there. So to fill that gap, we need to have lifelong learning. And when we are having this skill, then only we can ask students also. You see, students generally emulate us. So by looking at us, they will try to emulate. So as a teacher, we should be first in practicing this. Then naturally, looking at us, students may try to emulate, try to learn. So basically, we need to focus more on outcome-based education. Previously, it was like input-output model. If you see 9th class, 10th class, 7th class, so generally, how many students are enrolled? Let us say 60 students are enrolled. How many are able to pass? Let us say 56 people are able to pass. So they will calculate the pass percentage with respect to output by input. So how 56 people are cleared and 60 people are there, then they'll calculate the ratio. So only they worry about whether student is able to pass or not. So then they will push them into intermediate, then they'll be pushing engineering. So coming to engineering again, because they are already habituated in input output model. So similarly, but in engineering what happens, suddenly in first year we have very less pass percentage. So why? Because they are coming from input output model. From input output model, we should take them in outcome based education. Outcome based education. What is the outcome? So previously, whether teacher is teaching class or not, that is important. But in outcome based, so teacher is not that important. Student, whether he is able to learn or not, that is important. So that is why I'm saying, if you teach more, they will learn less. If you teach less and make some activities, then they will learn more. So always we should think that whether we are able to teach, we have to make them learn more or not. So if you want to make them learn more, you have to think in three domains. So one is called attitude, knowledge and skill actually. So first one is a cognitive skill, or you can say knowledge skill. So this is with respect to Bloom's taxonomy, we can inculcate cognitive skills or knowledge skills among the students, and we should have a rubric to check whether the student is able to learn or not. Similarly, we have psychomotor skills. Engineering required a lot of psychomotor tests. For example, you can see electrical engineer should know how to really make this installation of transmission line in jungles or somewhere else. Similarly, civil engineering should know how to lay the roads or bridges. He has to go to physical field and he should do. So many such mechanical engineering also should able to know how to work on lathe machine and other machines. Similarly, electronic person, person with EC, he should know how to work with this printed circuit boards, the soldering, how to design complex circuit, etc. Even computer science engineers also, depending upon the application, IoTs, etc. He required to have the psychomotor skills. So this we can define with Dave's technology, and with this technology, we should have again a rubric to check whether our students are able to learn this psychomotor test skills or not. And all the practical what we do in engineering are with respect to the psychomotor test. So we will test them whether he's able to learn the programming or not, whether he's able to perform experiments or not, whether he's able to do project or not. So all these things with respect to psychomotor test. Then coming to affective skills. Affective skills are very important. Affective skills are all about ethics, all about emotional intelligence, how we feel, how we talk, how we think, and how we work in teams, how we are having empathy. So this is mostly lacking in engineering education actually. So that we need to inculcate. You see, if you see any engineering college, especially among teachers, so faculty, we have to be very polite with the faculty. If we otherwise people when they are working in the departments, etc., if you are not polite with your colleagues, so generally they start avoiding you and all those things. So even at family members, with family members also, we should be very polite. We should have effective skills. If you don't have effective skills, so this generation is like, so we used to listen to our parents. So, but now our children are not listening properly. So because they are new generation kids actually. So this generation is, they listen to their elders and now they are even listening to their children. So that is the change in the generation. But the new generation, they should inculcate this habit of affective skills, and we should have rubric. So that is how, when we are taking the project drivers, etc., we see whether he is properly dressed or not, whether he is able to speak properly or not, whether he is in interviews also, we see how his behavior, how is it attitude. So even in class also, when teacher is having some marks in his hand, you will see whether he is regular or not, how he is talking to teacher, how he is behaving in class. So all these things are there. So this behavior skills also very important. So that is affective skills, and we can learn this with respect to our rubric we can create with Krathwohl taxonomy. So in Bloom's taxonomy, we have remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and create. So generally, if you take in 10th class or intermediate, whatever we studied, so generally we studied only rote learning, memorizing. So all these things will come in remember and understanding. So this is called low level understanding actually. So let us say, what is Ohm's law? What is Defiant law? Right, mathematical formula for Ohm's law. So that is all comes in remembering and understanding. So with that, really he is not able to make use of this Ohm's law in his professional life actually. So instead of that, we should make students in class or giving assignment, you see that he should able to apply that Ohm's law analyze the Ohm's law, evaluate the Ohm's law, create a circuit using Ohm's law. Let us say you are electrical engineer, then you should know how to design a 2 ampere 30 volts regulator using voltage source controller using Ohm's law. That you can design. If you are a computer engineer, generally what you would say, you display hello world using C program. Then you say display hello world using Java, display hello world using Python. So most of the programs we stop with the hello world only, but we should take them to solve complex problem. Let us say, how many of you really think that you have made students to design A inverse for n by n matrix? So designing A inverse for n by n matrix is a very challenging problem. You think how many of you have really given this type of problems to students? So generally we stop at remember and understanding. So this is called low level thinking order skills. From low level thinking order skills, we should take them to higher order thinking level skills actually. That is apply, analyze, evaluate and create. Coming to Dave's technology, Dave's taxonomy. So if you want to learn the driving, so first we have to imitate actually. So if you have to see how the driver is driving, then try to manipulate, you see what he's doing, how he is changing the clutch, how he is making the V, that steering, how he is having movement, how he is using the brake, where is he looking, all these things you have to see, imitate, manipulate, then with his help we should learn, then we have precision, we should able to articulate. When you learn driving, so while talking, I am not saying that you should talk and drive, but I am just telling, while talking to the person who is sitting beside, or maybe sometime over phone also, one way he is talking and he is riding, sometime he is thinking something else about the urgent work in office, and also unknowingly is driving. So this is called natural aeration. So with relaxed mode one can drive actually. So in psychomotor test, one has to start with imitation, then go to manipulation, then precision, articulation and natural aeration. Natural aeration is a perfection. So for example, swimming. So swimming initially, he has to see how people are swimming. Then once he jump in the pool, he will swallow a lot of water. Then from there, when he become his expert swimmer, then with very ease, he can swim actually. So he will float in the water. So that is the level of skill. Similarly, when we are doing all the engineering, let us say I want to work with electric motor or generator. So initially I will be scared to work with electric motor or even lathe machine. So once I try to use it, then I will feel that comfortable with that, then only naturalization will work. So we have to take students to this naturalization actually. So then we have Crathwohl technology. So this is a taxonomy. This is a receiving, responding, valuing, organization, characterization. So basically many things we need to understand, we need to experience, we need to feel, we should have emotional intelligence, values, ethics. So we need to understand this Crathwohl technology, how we can excel. So it is very difficult to follow this taxonomy. So we need to practice culture, ethics. So you can start with yourself, you can start with your family members, you can note down where you are going wrong, whether you are becoming angry, or when, how to respond to, you have to think properly. You should have some outlook, then only we can try to implement this. So when you are working in teams, you should have ethics. You should not take credibility of others' work. You should try to help others. So sometimes we should selfless, always you should not be selfish. So all these things we can practice using this Crathwohl technology. So start from receiving, responding, valuing, organization and characterization. So this is the ladder for this. Then all this education, we need to understand that program educational objectives and program outcomes. Let us say we want to become a civil engineer, or we want to make students to become as civil engineer. Then we should understand what are the objectives of civil engineers. So when student will go out of engineering, finally he should able to construct the building, he should able to design the design the map of the building, and he should design the foundation. He should know what, how much depth he should go, what to be the foundation, what material is required, what type of steel thickness is required, which type of cement he should know, what is the size of this pillar, all these things he should know. So in PO itself, you have to design, you have to state that when a student go through this program, he will become a reliable civil engineer who can able to demonstrate its skill with respect to building, construction, bridges, all those things. So you have to define. So when students or parents, when looking for some of the program where their ward should join, so naturally that should be defined. And not only definition, we should also see that the student, when he goes out from the college, you should have those skills. So that is called program educational objectives. Then program outcomes. You have to break this program educational objectives into small pieces, and that is with respect to graduate attributes, whatever we discussed in the first slide. That you have to write with respect to your own particular program. So that is called program outcomes. Then program outcomes means student should have the mathematical knowledge, able to solve the complex system, works in team, interdisciplinary. All these things are there in program outcome. So when you break down this program outcome with respect to the courses, that is called course outcomes. And all this measurement of outcomes is done by this course outcomes. And when you are going in class delivering the course outcome, you have to break into pieces. Then that is called learning outcomes. So each class will have learning outcomes. Even this class which I am taking now also is having learning outcomes. What is the learning outcomes? So innovative teaching learning methods, that is what all the participants who are listening without muting or without disabling the voice, they, if they listen properly, they may understand. So that is the outcome of this. So before taking class itself, if you are able to tell students that this is what you are going to learn, if he's interested, then naturally we'll try to listen and follow your class. Similarly, all these things are measured. It's not like that you work hard and nobody is going to observe. So accreditation agencies and ranking agencies, they are measuring. So NBA, National Board of Accreditation, the National Assessment and Accreditation Council, National Institute Ranking Framework, this NBA, NAC and NRF, they are measuring all these things. So yesterday only we got 172 NRF ranking actually. So over 6,000 people are participated. And we got 172 rank. Previously, we had 179th rank in 2019. So by seven ranks, we improved. But it takes a lot of effort and challenging activity to do to improve our ranking. So, and NAC, so we are A-grade accredited. NBA, we have NBA for all the programs, both EG and PG. So it takes a lot of efforts, a lot of time, a lot of teamwork to make all these things. So one has to really follow these things in engineering education. So in a nutshell, what is outcome-based education is, we should have proper vision and mission. So I have already told the three type of taxonomies, that is psychomotor skills, cognitive skills, affective skills, or domains, if you call knowledge domain, psychomotor domain, and you can say emotional domain. So you should see that the students who are going out from our institution should have all these things. So with respect to that, we should make a vision and mission of the institution. Then departments also should have their vision and mission in line with college vision and mission. Then break down to PEOs, PBOs and COs. This is called a design. This is top-down approach. When you are executing, it is bottom-up approach. So when you are evaluating students, so then you have to have the understanding of learning outcomes, how much of course outcome. So again, you will have rubric. So we will have direct and indirect assessment. So with that, we will try. We will evaluate course outcomes. From course outcomes, we will evaluate POs. From POs, PEOs, like that, we will do actually. So that every teacher should understand these things. Then only we can really survive in this field actually. So coming to this Bloom's taxonomy, so slowly from remembering, rote learning, memorizing to we have to think to take them to creative level. Now you see in future we can have open book examination. Now in pandemic, so the exam whatever we are conducting is rote learning or memorizing. So people are not interested. With that, they are not learning. So even after 25 years, 22 years education also, if student is not employed, means what he is learning with memorizing and rote learning, mugging up. So you see, if I ask how many marks you got in Telugu or English in your 10th class, you may not remember. So why? Because that is not very important also. So why we should remember everything? So instead of that, we should try to have these skills like apply, analyze, evaluate, create. So when they go to industry, you see a lot of things are there in manual, it is there in online. So using all available knowledge, you should be able to design the complex solutions to the complex or easy solutions to the complex problems. So that is how we have to make students. Now AICTE is also thinking of open book examination. Now you see Coursera and edX and all those things, they have designed already evaluation online actually, but somehow in India still we are orthodox thinking actually. So we don't believe our students. Always we think that when there is a scope, they will copy. But you try to increase the level of the standard of the question paper and make it little complex so that maybe verifying books also, you should really work hard to solve those problems, give some time. So we have to think differently and see that situationally how we have to give open book examination and how we can make students to go to this analyze, evaluate, create level using our examination assessment pattern actually. So teacher also should able to make MCQs or writing questions with respect to these things. So what I say that 30 to 40% because same day we cannot change our standards. So 30% to 40% still you can ask, understand, remember level. But 60% of the paper you can slowly start take them to analyze, apply and evaluate. So you can say create, evaluate, you give 30%. Analyze, apply, you can give 30%. And 40% in understand, remember. So when you're taking class, when you're developing your content, when you're writing question paper, all those things you have to think of these type of things. Then only we can improve the teaching standards in India and in our colleges. So then you can ask, what should we do? So these are all the teaching methods to have this type of, if you use this type of methods, then you can inculcate higher order thinking skills. So generally what we do, we teach the thing in the class, we start from the basic level. So it is like some people will say that we tell them that how to make white rice and finally we'll ask them to make a biryani kind of thing. So instead of that, what we should do is we should make a video that how to cook rice and we should put in video. Then when you are coming to class, then we should make preparation to prepare a biryani, Hyderabadi biryani you can say. So the Hello World program or the basic Ohm's law, you teach in a video and keep it in YouTube, give a link in Moodle so that students who are coming to your class. So basic knowledge they will be having already when they go through this thing. So those who have already seen these videos, they should be able to perform well in the class. And then you give complex problem in the class. So that is called flipped classroom. So flipped means ulta. So make the process ulta, that is flipped classroom. Easy thing, remember understanding level you give in videos and do analyze to create design. All these things in the class. So then students, you can engage them in active learning and student also enjoy your class. Otherwise, they are not interested to listen to our classes. They are not interested to attend the classes because it is whatever you're teaching is already there in Google or YouTube. So basic information you again give in Google or this YouTube, Google Classroom, whatever. Then complex things you can solve in classroom, break them in teams and have competition among students. So we have to, these are all new things we have to practice. So then peer learning. So let us say if you want to teach your children something. So it is very difficult to teach. But same thing, his colleagues, his classmates can tell them easily. So peer learning is very important. Let us say when you want to teach a solution for an integral differential equation to your students, so they hardly understand. But if somehow some intelligent student understand the concept, when he teaches to his colleague students, then easily they will understand. So why? Because we are at other generation. We are a different generation and they are a different generation. They learn at ease with their colleagues actually. So we should also create this component of peer learning in their classroom. So then students, they will enjoy your classroom and they learn a lot. Then we should make these teams and we should give this think, pair, share activity. So we should pose a problem, then we should ask them to think and let them make a pair of some few students and let them deliberate on the problem and let them come out of solution and let them share to the class. Whoever is having a good solution, you appreciate them and ask other students to clap for them and all these things you can make, motivate, so that after class also they will discuss what happened in the class. I did well, sir has appreciated, students are curious to know about my problem. So that is what we require. Otherwise they chit chat or something else, what is happening, politics, movies, etc. So if you inculcate these things, really there will be a good discussion forum. Then case based learning. So you see Nokia, what happened to Nokia? Now why the Nokia is not in the business now? Why the Redmi or Apple? So Apple is now crossed $1.5 trillion. So it is almost our Indian economy actually. So much money they are making business actually. So how they are making this business? Similarly, China has completely controlled this coronavirus. Why India, why we are not able to control? US is the number one in the world. Why they are suffering with 20 lakhs cases? So we have to take a case and we have to analyze cases. Similarly, you see New Zealand has totally eradicated this coronavirus. When New Zealand is able to make it, why not America? Why not India when China is able to make it? So always we talk high end when coming to the work, why we are not able to do that. So all these things we have to take a case and how they have done, we have to do meticulously and try to come to conclusion. So that is called case-based learning. So here student is given a paper and he will ask to read in half an hour, 20 minutes, then ask him to give his points, discuss. So those things possible in case-based learning. Then experiment learning. So if you want to teach IoT, etc. So if you teach, the student will not learn. So now what you have to do, you have to give one processor to them, maybe a Beagle board, Arduino or Raspberry Pi something, and give some sensors, give some Python programming or some programming, whatever you have, Arduino, many, many programmings are there. So use let them use that programming, let them use sensor, let them use internet, let them use this Beagle board, or this Raspberry Pi, Arduino. So let them do some activity, connect to internet, connect to laptop, do something. So they learn a lot using this experiment learning than what you teach actually. Then project-based learning. So project-based learning is also very important. So how we will make them learn using these technologies? So we have to think. So this will take them to complex learning patterns actually. So this is what the flipped classroom. So we have to make students to learn simple things before class, and during class they have to spend their time in analyzing and the complex activities. Then after class also they can improve on higher order applications and evaluation, etc. Then peer learning. So peer learning is all about the peer group and they learn quickly when they are working with students, their colleagues. Then this is think, pair, share. So we have to make them in groups and see that they will learn using groups. Then case-based learning. So this is what case-to-case, how they can analyze a case, where that case has gone wrong, where they are doing well, what has happened. From beginning to end, different cases they'll compare and they'll learn new things using case-based learning. Experiential learning. So we can have feedback, reflection. We can have concept. We can have experimentation. Then we have the concrete learning actually. So let us say if you want to learn football, so if I teach about football for 100 hours, you will not learn anything. So, but if you really go to football field, if you really hit a football, then you'll understand. So if from one place to other stand, if you want to take this football, then if you hit, you may really cramp your leg actually. So you have a lot of muscle pain and 2 days you cannot get up actually if you hit like that. So slowly you should understand that how to hit a football. It's not that easy to hit football just like that. So slowly we have to take, that is called experiential learning. Otherwise, student will see in video that, okay, so and so person is hitting football like that. If you try to like that, then he'll have a lot of pain in his leg and he may not really walk also. So slowly we have to learn. Similarly, let us say somebody is jumping in water. So if you try to jump in water, people may die actually. So there is a skill. Everything is having skill. So experience, so we have to take experience of the people and slowly we have to learn. So that is called experiential learning. Experiential learning means really learning by doing actually. So then project-based learning. So we have to learn through different phases of the project. We have to learning. It is something like a design thinking. So when we make a product from idea to product, so lot of things we have to do. So every stage we learn, every stage we should compare with the required thing and where we are lacking, and we have to improve upon those things actually. So then the lifelong learning, how we can make it. Not only students, teachers, everybody should learn new things because technology is changing. It is a disruptive technology. Lot of changes are coming. So we need to learn from the Swayam, NPTEL. These are all the Indian platforms, but not only Indian platforms. Now we have to compete with other countries also. Finally, our students are going abroad, and when they go there, they are saying that education in Europe and America, it is better than India. Then why can't we give better education in India itself? So for that, we need to see edX, Coursera, Udemy. You see how they are preparing videos, how they are preparing content. So we should be in a position to prepare this type of contents, how people are enjoying, how people are engaged. So we should learn, and also we can upgrade the skills using these type of platforms. Then at least I recommend at least one course continuously. We should be enrolled at least one course all the time. After one course, another course we have to go. Then we should also when we learn this course, now we have to implement also. We have to implement through Moodle, that is learning management system. Then we need to understand the softwares are conducting online classes. Now let us say, previously I have never used this Zoom, but now I have learned how to use Zoom, how to take class in the Zoom, all these things. So these are all new things. So we need to learn these new things. Then software video recording. So previously we only used to take chalk and board type of classes, but now I learned how to record my video. So we have Screenomatic software and so many software. So I myself can record my video for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I have my own YouTube channel. I know how to upload my video in YouTube channel. Things have become very simple now. So only thing, we need to spend our time in that, and almost everything is we can learn self only. So by self exploring we can learn. So one has to do all these things. Then we should have interactive presentation software. Then we should know how to learn these things. Then software for rubric creation. So rubrics are very important. So we should know how to create this rubric. Rubric, in a simple term, when you are taking seminar, you create a rubric. How is his PPT? How is his technical knowledge? How is his communication skill? How is his dress? Whether he is able to answer the questions or not? Whether he is going in depth or not, whether he has copied. So all these things you make a rubric, and average, good, below average, above average, and all these things you make, and based on that you give marks. So this is a rubric. So this rubric we have to implement at many places these days actually. So then we have to create software for online assessment and submission. You see these days now so many online quizzes are coming. So people have already become experts in Google forms and all those things. So every teacher now, they should learn all these things. Otherwise, we'll go back. So we should always ask every day when we take class, then evening we should give quiz. So we should make some good students take part in creating quiz and ask them to act as a mentor. So we can do many things actually. So if we know, then only we can make students to learn and help you in a teamwork and all those things you can do. And also, this type of, these are all the learning management system most of you may be knowing. Google Classroom, Online Moodle Cloud, OpenEdX LMS, Camellio, Edmodo, Piazza, Canvas. So many things are there. Similarly, like this is now Zoom we are conducting. So I have used Cisco WebEx also. Skype regularly we are using. GoToMeeting, WebEx, so Google Hangout, Microsoft. Everything I have used actually. So everybody should know it is how we can really conduct a meeting. So now Google Meet also there. So we have to explore all these things and learn how to conduct meetings, how to join in this meeting and etiquettes of this meeting, etc. Then we have softwares for video recording. So myself, I use Screenomatic from last 2-3 years. I'm using this software. So similarly, others also one has to learn. YouTube Live also I have explored with help of our faculty members. Then others like Flashback Recorder, Zoom, Prezi, PowerTone, Epic. I am just giving only few things. There are hundreds of video recording softwares are there, both paid and free also. Then interactive presentation software. You see Microsoft PowerPoint. You can see this is a Microsoft PowerPoint only I'm using. Then Mentimeter, Google Slide, Joho Show, Slide, Zoomit, Prezi, etc. Then rubric is very important. So if you want to analyze, so even if somebody goes to interview, whether he's selected or not, so that is depend with respect to rubric only they will decide. So what is his etiquette? How he is speaking? What is his knowledge? So various parameters, how is his communication skill, coding skill, like he will create a rubric and based on rubric only he will decide. And finally, he has to appraise to his higher management that how you have selected so-and-so candidate. So for everything, if you are giving project marks in comprehensive Viva, seminar Viva or wherever. So everywhere we need to create rubrics. So there are some softwares those which can help us in creating rubrics. So iRubric, Rubric Maker, Quick Rubric, Ruby Star, many are there. I'm just naming few. Then we have online assignment submission. So already you may be knowing this now. Most of you are submitting e-quizzes actually. So Google, they are created using Google Form, Google Classroom, Edpuzzle, GitHub, and not limited to only this thing. Many are there. Then you see now world is changing. So previously we used to ask, let us say if you want to go somewhere, we used to stop our car and we used to ask that where this road will go, how to find this location, etc. But now who is asking anybody? So now coronavirus, nobody is coming down from their car. So everybody is asking, taking Google Maps, and whatever doubts are there, previously they used to ask teachers and parents. Now it is not required. Now Siri is there, Google Assistant is there, Alexa is there, Cortana is there. So what I mean to say is this new generation kids have a lot of technology. So they know how to manage themselves and they know how to learn. Okay. And everything is now written with artificial intelligence. So now, the social media. So this in online, even though if the coronavirus, let us say coronavirus stops spreading and let us say we don't have this, we have world without any coronavirus, then also we should use social media because our children are like, they are born with social media. So they are engaged in social media. So they know always they are in Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, WhatsApp, Instagram, PUBG. You see, children, you will not believe that they are waking up midnight 2 o'clock, midnight 12 o'clock. They are making videos and they are posting that video. For example, girls, they will apply a lot of lipstick powder. Or boys, they may apply powder. They comb their hair in the midnight 12 o'clock and they will make a funny video. They'll upload that in TikTok and watch up to evening 5 o'clock that how many their friends are liking their videos. So they are becoming crazy actually. Similarly, Instagram, each student, they are spending 4 to 5 hours time in Instagram. WhatsApp anyhow, they are spending more than an hour every day. So they are hooked to this social media. Similarly, PUBG. those who are playing PUBG, they are becoming half mad actually. If you see PUBG, they are already now earning tens of thousands of crore rupees actually with making them addicted in multimedia and social media. So similarly, if you see Netflix, Amazon Prime, Hotstar, they are using artificial intelligence to grab their attention. If you go to Netflix, so already Netflix will analyze your emotions, your thinking, your behavior, what you like, what you don't like, and he will give which movies you may probably watch, and naturally you may watch those movies actually. So if similarly YouTube also, it will predict what type of videos you like, and those videos they'll put in pipeline. So everything is running with artificial intelligence. So when people are using social media, when they are addicted in social media, if you teach boring class with chalk and talk, when you turn that side to the board, if you want to write something, who will going to listen our classes? So that is why we should also try to use the social media. One of the edX professor Agarwal is saying that when he is asking his daughter that do you have your dinner, so daughter is not responding. So then he went to the WhatsApp, and in WhatsApp he asked, beta, did you have your dinner? Then say yes, papa. So why? Because they are more attentive towards the social media. It's not like they are ignoring us, but they are in social media. So if you talk with respect to social media, naturally they start liking your class, they start liking the technology. So that is how we have to grab the attention of the students and use similar platforms to make them learn. Then disruption in education. So that is what disruption in education. So from chalk talk to, we should go to online education, a Coursera type, a edX type of education. Then we have to make them engaged actually. So if you get green tick, we'll feel very happy. So that the dopamine increase happening with the green tick. So people will feel happy when they see green tick. So that is what the perks, what we are giving to students. They feel very excited when they get 100 out of 100. So use some tricks in this education, make them attracted towards this disruption in education. So disruption in education means destruction in education. So old education system is destructed and new are coming. So that is what innovation happening. So there are opportunities, there are challenges. You have to take steps with respect to these things. So what are the opportunities? Opportunities, new technologies are our opportunities. What are the challenges? So from old method, I have to change to new method. Then only I can survive. Otherwise, we cannot survive. Then we should inculcate, create critical thinking and creativity. So everywhere, every software company, every hardware company, they are thinking about creativity and critical thinking. You see every other day, every 3 months, Redmi is coming with a new phone. Cost is less, technology is high. How they're coming? So they're coming with critical thinking and creativity only. Then all these things you have to inculcate, encouraging students with professional bodies and student clubs. At GRIT, we have, you name any club we have. So we encourage students to learn out of the classroom more actually. So because students are not interested to learn sitting through in the class actually. So we should give opportunity. So at least every Saturday, we should make so many events happening in the campus. So it will be lively campus. Now our campus is looking like deserted. With students, when they are there in the campus, when they are moving around, we will feel very happy actually. When there is a pin drop silent, everybody is sitting class. So then learning is not happening actually. When they are outside the campus, when they are talking, collaborating, discussing, making events, having fun, then only they learn a lot. So we need to create this IEEE student body, Computer Society India, ISTE. So many student bodies are there. Recently, we have created Indian Green Business Council student body, SME is there. Our students are making all-terrain vehicles. Similarly, we are members in Confederation of Indian Industry, India-US or India-Universal Collaboration for Engineers, then ICT, Information Communication Technology Academy, Oracle Academy. We have LabVIEW Academy in our college, Microsoft Academy. So through this, encourage faculty and students learn new things. We have Photography Club, Rhythms, Spirals, Spices, Quizzicals, Advanced Academic Center. Advanced Academic Center is to make students, those who are fast learners, so give them opportunity to excel in their education when they are engineering itself. Then we have innovation lab, tinkering lab, PCB lab, project lab, hackathons. Conduct hackathons. We are conducting pan level hackathons, giving 1 or 2 lakh cash prizes. So pan India, we have conducted 2 national hackathons these days actually. But now due to Corona breakdown, this time we have to delay. But we, on and off, we are conducting many hackathons. Then we should encourage faculty and students become member in free software club, robotic club, gaming club, NSS. So our students have done some good events, distributing food, etc. Blood also in this Corona pandemic. Then we have green campus, street cars, e-sale, etc. E-sale is for entrepreneurship. So these are all the few student bodies which we encourage. And also I request all the members who are attending this conference to encourage students. So there should be a balance in classroom activity and out of the class activity. And you have to strike correct balance. And whenever students are given freedom, you have to monitor. It is not like micromanagement, but you have to manage them properly so that they will not fight and all those things. With in a congenial atmosphere, they should conduct the event. So you have to create that ambience. Then only they'll start liking to come to college regularly. Then we should also make students to learn the simulation tools, because the solutions required by the new world, the 21st century, is very complex actually. So that is why we should make them learn MATLAB, LabVIEW. So these are all the proprietary software, but R programming, C or Python, they are all free software. So let them use the software as per their choice and let them learn new things. Then also in this pandemic now we are able to take classes, but what about labs? So all the teachers, they should know the skills to make their labs using virtual labs. So MHRD has developed many virtual labs. So College of Engineering Pune, so many IITs, so many universities in abroad, Europe and America, they are coming up with lot of virtual labs. So as a teachers, we should explore these virtual labs, take our students in virtual labs, and we should be in a position to conduct these virtual labs actually. Then we have IIT Bombay tutorials. You see, lot of tutorials are there. We should make students to have a habit of learning using IIT Bombay spoken tutorials or many other Khan Academy is there. Many are there. So let them learn as per their choice. Then e-assignments, surveys, feedbacks. So we should able to develop all these tools. Also make students to do these things for us, for their team. So then only this learning curve will increase. Then this PSPICE, multi-SIM, computer-aided design, AWS, so many things are there. So we should inculcate these things. And emerging technologies. So these are all the emerging technologies. Now in GRIT, we are now in this year, we are starting 4 new programs. So one is CSE in artificial intelligence and machine learning, CSE in data science, then computer systems and business systems, M.Tech data science. So all these courses we are starting because a lot of demand is there. So now people are talking about artificial intelligence, robotics, 3D printing, cybersecurity, blockchain, AR, VR. Now we are having a lab with Facebook in AR, VR. Similarly, now we have already procured 4 or 5 drones. Our students, we have already have some $5,000 project in drones, big data, quantum computing. So drones are flying around our campus and our students are doing some analysis using drones. Faculty are competent to teach our students in drones. So we need to learn these skills actually. So because of autonomous college, we are able to include all these things in our curriculum. Similarly, those who are having autonomous college, you can include. If you are not autonomous college, at least you can conduct workshops on these technologies. Then we should have additive manufacturing, electric vehicles. Myself, I guided one electric vehicle. So already one electric vehicle is running in our college. So we need to encourage students to come up with these type of things. Then cloud computing, Internet of Things. So recently I have done one course on Internet of Things. So only thing we should learn and explore ourselves. Then we should learn agile thing, automation, DevOps. You see, a lot of software jobs are now people are removing them from job because now testing engineers are not required because they are going to agile. Agile means the fellow, the software engineer should able to code, able to test, able to do everything actually. So in bits and pieces, we should know everything. Then only we can survive in the market or the software companies. So from the teaching level, when we are teach this agile model to the student, then only they will survive in this competitive world in the software companies actually. Automation also, you see, everyday automation. So we need to learn automation and DevOps, etc. So these are all the emerging technology. Quantum computing is there. And all other things. So artificial intelligence. So if you are going around, so everything, you are being watched by computer. So if you are typing something in Google, so Google is already predicting. So better than anybody in the world, Google can predict what you are going to type. Similarly, when you are going Facebook, what type of links you will like. Similarly, already I told about Netflix, Amazon, YouTube, etc. Also, you see, if you want to book a flight, so already computers know that what you are looking for. So they will immediately give so many ads. If you want to book a room, if you want to book some iPhone, or if you want to book at least headphone, whatever you are searching. Let us say today you try with violin. If you want to buy a violin, so hundreds of ads, you will see violin everywhere, wherever you are going in social media or internet. Why? Because background, your lot of programming is going on. This. So one has to know how the computer is thinking, because now you know how to live with people in the world, but now we should learn how to live with the computers, how we learn with the machines. So unless we understand the language, what they know, so really we cannot make much difference in our professional growth actually. So all we need, finally, see, I'm an electrical engineer, but I have explored all these algorithms and little knowledge I have. So every teacher should know, and we should talk them in this language only. So supervised learning, unsupervised learning, reinforced learning. So all these things, we should at least have some basic knowledge, and linear regression, logistic regression, decision tree, Navy bias. So if you are now corona, somebody is saying that after August in India, we may have 5 crore, 3 crore corona cases. How they are predicting? They are predicting with Navy bias predicting algorithm. So every 12 days, it is doubling. So there are some concept, probability. So probability, and they take the evidences with that, they will try to predict actually. Then k-nearest algorithm, support vector machine, k-means clustering, deep learning, neural networks, fuzzy logic. So many things are coming. So all teachers in each field, we need to apply. So that is what called multidisciplinary. So if you think about multidisciplinary, then only we can really make our student learn. So if you are using IoT, again, you have to use artificial intelligence. So let us say you're in class. So maybe now 1 or 2 years, you will not really require to take attendance. So CCTV itself will see how many people are coming into the class, who is learning with their facial expressions, whether they are copying in examination hall or not, whether physically they are able to attend the class. You don't need to take any feedback. Computer itself will tell you that how is the feedback of a teacher, how is his clarity in communication, whether students are attentive or not, whether they are noting down, whether what they are doing, whether they are going through Moodle, LMS, everything, artificial intelligence can predict for you. So in future days, this teaching is going to become a different thing actually. So in view of this, the life of teacher has becoming complex, challenging roles are there. So we need to really have new things actually, like online online evaluation, mentorship, documentation. We have to do a lot of documentation for this NBA, NAC, NRAF, UGC, AACT, JNT, many are there. Then again, not only online teaching, offline teaching, we are supposed to do some administration work. We should have continuous evaluation. You see, previously, when we were children and we used to write exam once in a year, then now we are working in semester. In semester also, we are conducting 2 exams, then midday exam, then lab exams, then so many e-quizzes. So now people are going towards continuous evaluation process. So every day we have to evaluate students. So every day means how challenging it is. But we have to make that at ease with respect to the computers, with respect to the Google Forms, the technology. So we should make our technology work for us. Then there is a challenging demand that we should do research work, we should do paper publication, a Scopus indexed paper, Science Citation Index, patents, we have to work in patents, project proposal, books chapters. So it is not that we will work in only one activity. We should know in bits and pieces, we should explore all the fields actually. Then we also require to do some consultancy, work on intellectual property rights. Also, you see, now they are talking about entrepreneurship, startups, etc. then this critical thinking, collaboration. We have to, you see, like, the role of teacher is connecting the dots actually. So students will have knowledge in bits and pieces, how to connect them, how to make them their life happy with listening to our classes, how we can become useful resource to the students. So that is what very important, problem solving. So also, you see, we cannot really bang them using computers and all those things. So we should have balanced screen time. So you can see some of the workshops, they are taking only half a day. So we should see that we should not have more screen time. Otherwise, they'll go mad actually. So why? What is happening with PUBG? People are becoming mad because they are addicted to the PUBG. So we should not take the screen timing to that level. We should see, restrict them that not more than 2-3 hours. We should not really drag them to these computers. And application oriented, emotional contact, group learning. We have to encourage this group learning. Then in our college, all the activities, whatever do, let us say seminar report, project report, mini project report, all these things, we are checking this out, plagiarism check with Turnitin, because they should not lift somebody's work and should claim their work. So we should ask them to do some quality work. Okay. So because after engineering, they are going to IITs, they're going to Europe, America, other countries for higher education. So they should have that practice from here itself. We should also, they should know what is the professional ethics. So that is why we are inculcating these things. Then encourage them in self-learning, blended learning, synchronous and asynchronous learning. So this is a synchronous. So if you, that spoken tutorial is asynchronous learning, blended learning. So all these things we should participate, also encourage students or colleague teachers to participate. And we should make class by using storytelling. And so students are new generation. So we are from old generation. We should try to talk to them using social media applications. We have to create this transformation. Then we should think of minimizing the memorization. We should go towards open book examination, challenging activities, challenging projects, seminars, discussion, all these things. And students or faculty should be able to create short videos. We should think of creating some projects that how to use AI in classrooms, improve quality of teaching. We should be able to create good video content. And we should create individual learning paths to the students through mentoring, of course. And now it is a dire need to create digital infrastructure. So students, other end, should have computer, internet, modem, optical fiber, everything. At our college also, we should have the internet connectivity, our servers required, then softwares are required, then internet bandwidth, then many things. People, experts are required. So nobody is expert. So again, we should become, take that cap and we should become expert. Create our own Moodle platform, our own server, and all those things we should explore, because we are all technical people. We should not stretch our hand for technical help from other sources. We should explore, learn and relearn, and all those things we should do. Then brainstorming, always create brainstorming among faculty members, students, let them harness their mind, create the joyful ambience in classroom, create the conducive learning platform. Then the difference between we and student is we are digital immigrants. So if you want to learn Google Forms, Google Suit, it is very difficult because we are digital immigrants. But you ask your students, just like that they learn, because they are digital native. They are born with lappy in their hand actually. So they know how to use iPhone better than us and how to use these computers, Twitter, Instagram. And if you want to create, delete Instagram, you just try, you cannot delete. But if you want to ask, delete Instagram account to your son or daughter, they can easily do it for you, because they know how to explore in social media. Similarly, we should have unlearn, learn, unlearn and relearn. You see, whatever we learn, it is obsolete. So it is like performer perish now. So whatever you know, it is all, you have to unlearn that. So it is like whatever water is there in the glass, you have to if you pour more water into the glass, it will overflow. So you have to throw that glass, you have to fill with some other liquid there. So that is called learn, unlearn and relearn. So this is a continuous process, and every day we have to do, we have to upgrade it. It is like upgrading Android. So upgrading is required, otherwise we are not compatible. Then design thinking. So we have already introduced this design thinking in first years and second years, so that students can have decision making and idea to product they can take. So what I want to give message is pedagogy first, technology is next. So first develop better pedagogy, understand the pedagogy, assimilate the pedagogy, then use technology to deliver this pedagogy. Then you ask questions, probing questions, leading questions, inspiring questions to make them curious in your subjects. Then problems are complex and interdisciplinary. Always keep in that mind and work towards that. So teacher has to take this five role model, like engage, explore, explain, elaborate, and evaluate. So this is our job in nutshell. So you see, everything is changing around us. So a lot of disruption is happening. You see, previously we used to go in auto, but now how many are using auto? So now we want Ola, Uber. So everything is working with cloud actually. Shopping, Amazon, Flipkart, learning Khan Academy, Byju's, digital payment. You see, now nobody is using cash, PayPal, Paytm, medical, IBM, Watson is dishing. So doctor now is asking IBM Watson that whether I should cut this nerve or other nerve. So all these things are happening because of this, the computer. So what I mean to say is, you see, they are all not related to our field, but every field is changing. That is what I am saying. So now it is a time that we should learn new technology and change. So now somebody may get disturbed. So I just want to tell in a nutshell about one of the concept, that how to improve ourselves actually. So this is a completely a new topic, but because we are in pandemic, every day we are reading about corona. So manaku kuda corona vachestada, so everybody is feeling scary actually. So I just wanted to just take some out of box things, that we should really work in self balancing thing. We should be poised, okay? We should be maybe when we are delivering our activities, we should be very cool, balanced. So this I can explain through a Japanese model called Ikigai. So generally now when we are improving our professional things, so we have to understand that what you are good at. You are good at something, and whatever you are good at, world may not need that. So also think that what world is asking. So what are the problems in the world? Whatever you are good at, with that can you solve the problems of the world? Then only people pay you. So what you can paid for, and also work for what you love. So this is defined by this Venn diagram. Four circles are there. So if you want to achieve that, you should have passion, mission, vocation means professional expertise and profession. Then when you balance all these things, then we will work with this self, the stable self actually, or special skills. So that is called Ikigai in Japan. There is one small book in internet. If you type, you'll get that book. So in nutshell, so there are 10 rules to follow this stable self actually. Stable, happy self. So that is what 10 rules are like. Stay active, don't retire. Okay. Then take it slow. So many things I have told. So you cannot follow all those things. Do it one by one, slowly, in a relaxed mode. So don't fill your stomach. So generally in India, we eat to 100%. So what we have to do is, at least I'm talking with respect to myself. So we should be able to eat 70%, and remaining we have to keep it empty so that we'll be active in our life. And now corona is there. So we will have stability with respect to corona, and we will have that we will become stubborn to this corona, and we can easily survive. So we should create the immunity in our body. So we have to eat only 70%, whether you can talk about breakfast, lunch or dinner. So 70%, if you, then diseases, no diseases will come. So this is all proven fact with Ikigai. So you can just type in internet, you will get this book. Then surround yourself with good friends. So make your life happy. So if you are happy in your mind, then the surroundings will be happy. If you are feeling bad in your mind, your surroundings will become bad. So whatever you are inside, that will project outside actually. So if you have good thoughts in your mind, if you are happy, then your surroundings will become happy actually. Then get in shape for your next birthday. So now we have to keep ourselves fit. because of this pandemic. Now we cannot go to hospitals. If we go to hospitals, we don't know what will happen. So now all doctors are losing jobs. Previously, they used to make a lot of money, but now because you don't have any diseases, don't have any patients, they are also losing jobs. So now our role is we should make ourselves in a good shape, and always we should have a smile. So if you have a smile, there will be good hormones in our body that will extend our life. If you feel bad, bad hormones will inject and that will create a lot of diseases in our body. Reconnect with the nature. So this is also there in NBA graduate, and also we should respect our nature. We are there because nature is there. If you don't have ozone layer, now ozone layer is also healing. Now you see from Chandigarh, Jalandhar, now we are able to see the Himalayas because of lot reduction in the pollution thanks to corona. So something bad things are happening, but some good things are also happening. So always think that we should also respect our nature, because we are living in the nature, and we should see that our nature also should live with us actually. We should not damage the nature, and wherever possible, please see that you inculcate this among yourself, your friends, and also in your students. Give thanks. So I met one of the American friend when he came to our college. Every other word he was saying, your work is appreciated, thank you so much. Your work is appreciated, thank you so much. So I asked why you are saying so much. He said, sir, it is there in our blood and our culture. For every small thing, we will thank. I liked him very much. So always, I also practice this. I also thank whenever some benefit I take. That is as a courtesy I thank, because so that will improve our relation. So always thank other people, show the gratitude, then live in the moment. So always enjoy your life, enjoy your moment. So don't think about past, don't feel about your future, what will happen with this corona, etc. Nothing will happen. So if you are happy and stable, nothing will happen. So always live in that moment. What you want to do in this moment, you take good decision and live up to that moment. So always be optimistic and hope for a bright future, and follow yourself. So you have inside guide is there in yourself. You will be guiding what is good and bad. So follow him and make yourself happy and have a balanced, good life. God bless you all. And thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to talk to you. Because this is what the pattern told me, that I should talk, then I can take questions at the end. So I'm happy that after talking, my mind has come to poise. I hope after listening to me, you also feeling that you are happy now. And thank you. And over to Sandhya and Kapil, and over to the audience for all the questions. Once again, thank you for giving me opportunity to talk to 373 people. So I'm very happy. If I am in class, I can only talk to 60. So thank to this technology that I'm able to talk with 373 people. Hope people are not sleeping other end, they are listening to me, because you can, with a click, you can avoid my class. But okay, who knows? But I think I'm a positive person. So I'm thinking that everybody listening to me. And if you ask one or two questions, that I can get confirmed that, okay, you are listening to me. And thank you so much. I am also feeling excited to talk to you, and over to you. To the admin, this admin. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I, Yash Ravanti, coordinator of this FDP, would like to convey our sincere thanks to our principal, sir. Sir, today's session provided us a great platform for understanding innovative teaching approaches. Your talk made us all realize that online teaching requires a lot of innovative methodologies and approaches put into practice to keep students engaged. With the knowledge you shared with us today about new trends and technology in education, we hope we reach the students in more effective and exciting ways. Sir, Ikigai Venn diagram was wonderfully explained by you. I hope everyone with this model try to overcome this pandemic situation with power. We thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time. Hope this session regenerates us to return to work with more passion and interest. Thank you once again, sir. Sir, today nearly 382 participants were online listening to your lecture. Sir, before we take queries, with your permission, shall we launch the poll question?
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I request Kapil, sir, to launch the poll question.
poll question has been launched. Kindly give your opinion. I request the participants who has logged in through mobile to accept all the pop-ups, notifications related to Zoom to answer the poll question. Poll question will be ended very shortly. Kindly answer the question quickly.
Yeah, dear participants, the poll question is displayed on the screen. Kindly attempt it. And the question is, what is your, do you agree the statement, the illiterates of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but rather those who can't learn, unlearn and relearn? Alvin Toffler. And the options are yes, no, don't know. Just we are having only 44 seconds more and 61% have voted. Attempting poll question is mandatory for the administrative purpose. Dear participants, all of you kindly attempt. Yes, 92% have voted yes and 17% have voted no and 2% have voted don't know. Yeah, the poll is going to end within a minute. So 78% have voted. I request all the participants kindly attempt the poll question as it is mandatory for getting e-certificate too. Okay, we have now closed poll question and you can see the results of poll question displayed on your screen. 91% for today's poll question, 91% voted yes, 22.7% no, and 2% voted don't know. Dear participants, now the forum is open for question and answers. If anyone of you are having queries, please raise your hands. Sir, now shall we take question and answers?
Yes.
Now I request Venkat Nageshwar Rao sir to kindly unmute from your side and ask your question. Yes.
Good morning.
Venkat sir, kindly unmute and you can ask your question.
Hello.
Yes sir.
Good morning sir. This is a very
sir, you increase your volume sir. You are
Hello.
Please.
You're telling me 12
again you have to increase your volume sir. You are very low in volume.
Okay. So you are listening?
Yes. Please go ahead. Yeah.
So good morning sir. This is a very crucial time. So I will continue the classes every day for online question in Gopalaram. Minister of Technology. So I'm working as professor in Pandora Cinemas, Minister of Technology, Chevetla. So this is a very nice section, sir.
Thank you.
Updating of Google Forms and Google Chat, everything, how to fill that. Very nice section. Thank you for your suggestion, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Next participant, I request Dr. Nirmal. Kindly unmute from your side and ask the query.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. Sir, can you please explain more about this rubrics assessment for students?
Yeah. Actually, rubric means you have graduate attributes, for example. You belong to which department, madam?
Actually, I am a dental college faculty.
Okay, if you are a dental college faculty, so let us say when you make student a dental practitioner, so the rubric should be let us say, how he is behaving with the let us say, I'm just giving an example with the patient. Yes. When yes. patient approaches him, whether the patients will try to believe him or not, or him or he or she, so believe them or not, like whether they are happily able to tell their problems, and when he is treating the patient, when he is able to treat them properly or not, whether he is having professional ethics or not, whether the instruments which he is using, whether he is taking proper cleaning or not, when he enters in his laboratory or in his the hospital, when everything looks clean and tidy or not, the way he is dressing, way he is talking, way he is using the method of treatment, what yeah. type of tablets he is giving, how empathy he is showing to the patient, and professionally whether he is giving correct medicine or not, whether he is really thinking like a making money or service model. So all these things you can make a rubric. So what okay. is so there are I told about 5 to 6 things actually. So yeah. how, what type of his professional knowledge, whether he is giving proper treatment or not, so what type of medicine he is giving, so whether he is giving the proper medicine, cost effective medicine, the treatment, so what type of treatment he is suggesting. If let us say the treatment will go only with having a tablet, or is asking them to go for a surgery. So okay. like that, we have to make different categories. There may be 7 to 8 categories.
Okay.
And how is etiquettes when he's okay. operating, when he's looking at that. Whether he's cleaning his hands or not, whether he's okay. wearing gloves, when the children will come, they will not try to touch, they will not allow people to open their mouth, and they're not allowed to put their instruments in their mouth. So how, like friendly nature, how is able to manage? So all these things are etiquettes. So, yeah. but dental practitioner require all these things. Example, I'm telling. So with this, whether he's good, poor, excellent, whether any improvements are, so you make a chart. So that is called rubric, madam.
Sir, actually, you said that it is more of ethical and behavioral assessment for a student. So when it comes to an online, how is it, like we are trying various ways to implement or mimic the situation in a virtual reality, because now we are in a situation where not every patient we can go and treat. So we are trying to mimic it to a virtual reality, but we are trying various ways where we can assess this, because the natural patient's emotions and expressions will be different. Though we can't mimic this. So, what other ways of rubric assessment is possible apart from this? Because as you said, rubric is not only the academic assessment, it is also the ethical and the behavioral assessment too.
Yeah. So, coming to this behavioral ethical means, madam, like for example, when we are writing, let us say, research paper, example, I'm telling. So most of the time, if we try to take, we cannot create complete data. We have to definitely take some data from some other sources. So when you are taking data, we have to give proper reference. So let us say, now I told about Ikigai. I already told that it is a Ikigai. It is a Japanese thing. There is a book on the internet. So when you type Ikigai, it will come. So I'm already claiming that it's not my own thing. It is, I have taken from Japanese Ikigai. So when you give proper references, proper these things, so that is a professional ethics actually. So, and coming to emotional intelligence, values, ethics, you cannot decide just like that, madam. So you have to observe the person, let us say in class, day to day, even in online also we can see, for example, when you see their pattern, when you conduct various examination, by taking results from various examination, you can predict that whether it is copied or what you can do. I'm just telling you, give one question, wrong answer. So when 100 people give wrong answer as a right answer, then you can understand that following some bad practices. So there is a method to evolve whether he is giving following ethics or not. So there are many methods. So using rubric is a one method, madam, but there are many online methods are there. So we have to be intelligent, more cautious, then we can identify. But with respect to behavioral affirmative skills, it is a little complex because generally Indians are a little poor in this affective skills, madam.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the information. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next query is from Kirti ma'am. Madam, kindly unmute from your side and ask the question.
Yeah, actually I'm a male. That's okay, no problem. Very good morning, sir. It was a very nice and informative session. I'm assistant morning, professor. Sir. I'm also from the faculty of dental surgery only.
Oh, great, great. I'm happy to talk to dentists.
My question here is, sir, we were into the practice of treating people all these days, and suddenly we went into this virtual reality world where we have to sit in front of computer from 9 to 3. If you don't believe, I've just finished my class at 9:30 and I've joined your session at 10. Okay. So, we are into the, you told about the Ikigai model, keeping yourself happy, involving with the nature. In this current situation, it is a little bit difficult because we have to see for the welfare of the students also. So, what is your personal opinion? What can be done to reduce the stress? So we are sitting from 9 to 3. And again, we are preparing for, you have also said, sir, we are into the world of evaluation, assessing. We are preparing for the next day's class again at 3 to 8 o'clock. Then we are starting our routine works after 8 in the night. Few days, we skip our lunch also. So in such situations, what is your personal opinion? What can be done to reduce our stress, both physically and mentally? Because after a few days, this will come back to normal.
Yes, sir.
Get back to our original state where we go treat the patients. So the transformation phase or this temporary phase, how can we manage, sir?
Yeah, nice, very nice question, sir. Actually, you see, I am also having quite busy life actually. So like how you are saying, I am also online, engaged in online activities, lot of institution load is there. So maybe yes, I am having highest institution stress actually. But what I do, because I already told that our life is in three basic parts actually. That is psychomotor domain, knowledge domain, and affirmative domain. So what I do in the college, since this stress is related to affective domain actually. So it is thinking, ethics, emotional intelligence. The stress is also in that domain. So when we have more cognitive things, the naturally stress will increase actually. So, but domains are different. So what I do generally now, for example, I'll tell you, yesterday I walked 10,000 steps actually yesterday. So when you go for walking, when you involve, that is called flow. In Ikigai, it is there actually, if you read that book. So okay, we have to enjoy our work where we find the flow. For example, if you like treating your patients with passion, then that will have a flow. In that flow, you will not feel bad or you will not feel stress. Similarly, if let us say I am a painter. I feel involved in that painting for hours together. I may skip even. I may not forget. I may forget that I should take lunch also. So most of the time, wherever you are good at, if you spend more time in that, then you will feel happy and you will not have stress. Also in Ikigai, it is said that you have to spend time with good friends. Those who are in the same frequency, those who are... can understand our emotion, those who give value to us, and if you are doing some good work, so if you have some good friends or even our children also, so if we spend some more time with them, then we will feel happy. So avoiding stress is only thing, we have to change the domain. So from cognitive domain to psychomotor domain, if you go, then naturally stress will come. So for that, we can do some, let us say I like walking, if you like swimming, but now we cannot do swimming, but or other physical exercise. When we do some physical exercise, the whatever blood is there in the brain, that will go to our muscles, etc. So we will feel tired and naturally chemical changes will happen in the body, and that stress automatic, the stress whatever you are feeling in the mind will reduce, and we feel active again. And when we get tired, we get good sleep also. Next day we'll come with full charge. So that is one thing. Or another thing is, whatever you like most, so if you can spend more time in that, you will feel your stress reduced. So these are all the two suggestions from me, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Next query is from Mr. Sunil Kumar. Kindly unmute yourself and ask the query. I request Mr. Sunil Kumar, kindly unmute and ask the query to sir. Yes.
No voice. I am not able to hear voice, sir.
Hello. Okay. Sunil sir, are you available?
Yes, I am available, madam.
Can you increase your volume? Can you increase your volume?
Sunil sir, we are hearing some noise from your side. Okay, we'll move to next query. I request Mr. Shant Kumar to kindly unmute and ask the query to sir. I request next participant, Mr. Shant Kumar, kindly unmute and ask the query. Yes. Next, I request Mr. Guru Prasad, kindly unmute and ask the query. Hello, I repeat, Mr. Guru Prasad, kindly unmute and ask the query. Sir, shall we take one more query?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, next I request next participant, Ms. Jayasree, kindly unmute and ask the query. Jayasree ma'am, kindly unmute from your side and please ask the question to sir. Sir is waiting. Okay, as the time is running out, we are just unable to take all the queries. So kindly mail your queries to edtechtoolsfdp.grit@gmail.com. Shall we end up the session, sir?
I think Padmaja, somebody is asking. Yeah. You give them opportunity. If they are ready, we can take one more question.
Okay, sir. Yeah, participants, now I request Dr. Padmaja, ma'am. Kindly unmute, please, from your side, and you can ask the query. Sir is waiting, madam. Padmaja, ma'am.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, yeah, please.
It was very good motivative session, sir, for me. I'm working as a professor in TKR College, sir.
Oh, great. Thank you.
So, sir, what is your suggestion to the teachers with chalk and duster? Those who don't know online, but they are very good at teaching. So, those who haven't touched.
It is a good question, madam. Actually, chalk and talk we cannot avoid. So from that is a traditional from last 10,000 years in India, we are using chalk and talk actually.
Yes,
so
sir.
And India is known for, that Takshashila, Nalanda. So from there, we are using this chalk and talk. So you cannot replace chalk and talk. But the situation is like now people cannot come to the class. So because of this pandemic, now children, for example, I am also thinking that I will not send my children to the school. If what happens if they catch corona? So everybody, because of situation. So situation is demanding that we cannot change.
Sir, do you think that we are all educated? Do you think that a kid has to go for 3 hours online classes? They also have some pain listening all the 3 hours, na?
Yeah, that is a good question actually. That is how I told the screen timings actually. So you can see Karnataka government, they already banned the LKG, UKG guys to use, yes, online mode actually. So that we can take decision. And the type of device which you are giving, the intensity, how, so that we can moderate. And you see, sometime we have to think what is society opting. So sometime we cannot reject actually. So, but you can take decision. If you are not able to send 3 hours, at least one and a half hour, you can ask your child to.
Actually, I'm a computer faculty only, sir.
Yeah.
I am also using LMS tool.
Okay.
Because to avoid, college is forcing us to follow those things. But to me, even my students have win that hackathons also.
Okay. Yeah.
Data sciences. But both I have seen, sir. To me, physical interaction and chalk and duster are the best thing, until to my perception.
So what I'm saying, I'm not denying you, but let us say that your students, when they listen to the class, so only the brightest student who is having inbuilt creativity and collaboration only can succeed. A natural, normal students only listen to you, note down. When he goes to industry, when somebody gives a IoT to him, beagle bone or raspberry pi, ask him to design an artificial intelligence algorithm to capture the facial expression using a camera, he really cannot integrate, because your class, whatever you taught, is remember up to analyze level. So unless we same class, you have to put in YouTube and whatever time, because student cannot spend more than 50 hours with you. So in yes. given 50 hours, if you spend more time in design creative level, then only the student will have happy life in professional career. Otherwise he will be a mediocre thing, and he have to learn from the scratch, and it will take long time to excel in professional life. I am not saying that that is bad or good, but I am saying what demands. So yes, today sir. You see, in India we are not able to make like Uber, Ola. So people, international people are coming, and they're using all their technology, even Microsoft, you see. So so all our money is going to different countries, because they are good at skills. So you can say iPhone is there. So Indian government, whatever budget is there, more than that they are earning $1.5 trillion they are earning. So what I mean is, technology is leading these days. Actually, you see, we have all auto wallas are there, cabs are there, but once Uber has come, Ola has come, so it has disrupted the market. Now you see Facebook, now Uber Eats has come. When Uber Eats is there, Zomato, or all these things are coming, the local vendors are not able to find business. Actually, what I mean is, unless we prepare to these things. So tomorrow, let us say in your college, your management says that only offline laboratories, online classes, then we don't have any go other than taking online classes. So mentally we have to prepare how we can take these classes more effectively, more engage them properly. Otherwise they will just mute your phone and they are out of your class.
Yes sir.
Yeah
sir, thank you so much sir. It was very positive, motivative session sir to me.
Thank you ma'am.
Some points also I have noted. Thank you so much sir.
Thank you. So thank you for the organizers, and thank you madam. Now you can close the session. Yeah
thank you sir. Dear participants, if you are having any queries, kindly write to edtechtoolsfdp.grit@gmail.com. thank you once again sir for sparing your valuable time and sharing your expert opinions with all of us. Thank you sir.
Thank you.
Dear participants, feedback link is posted in the Zoom chat box. Kindly submit it. It is open only for limited time. And kindly note that the feedback link will not be shared to the WhatsApp groups. Dear participants, it is mandatory to attend all the sessions and fill the feedback form every day to get an e-certificate. Now I thank all the participants for your active participation. Today, let's end up the session, and we'll meet tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. with the same Zoom credentials. Start joining at 10 a.m. to avoid network issues. Thank you, everyone. Have a good day.
So, dear participants, tomorrow is the last day of the FDP. We wish to see you all tomorrow, sharp at 10 o'clock. Thank you so much. It's goodbye from our side.